name is Iris Franz, and today we're going to talk about consumer surplus. So we economists use consumer surplus to measure the welfare consumers enjoy from participating in the market. So by definition, individual consumer surplus is equal to willingness to pay minus price. So for example, think about the computer you're using now to watch this YouTube video. How much did you pay for it? Suppose you pay for $1,000, then the price of that computer you're using is equal to $1,000. Now let me ask you, if the price of the computer had been $1,100, would you still pay for it? Then you scratch your head and say, yeah, I really need a computer, so probably I would still have paid for that. Now let me ask you again, how about $1,200? Then you'd be like, you're pushing it, but I think $1,200 is the maximum price I'll pay for it. I would not pay more than $1,200 for that computer. Then your willingness to pay for that computer will be $1,200, whereas the price is $1,000. Therefore, your consumer surplus for that computer is $1,200 minus $1,000. That gives you $200. So your consumer surplus for that computer you're using will be $200. Now, we don't just care about the consumer surplus for one consumer. We care about the consumer surplus for the entire market, all consumers, summing it up. So I'm going to use another example. Suppose we're in a babysitting market. So we have a mini market, we have several consumers, and they're trying to hire a babysitter so they can go out with their spouse maybe. And suppose the current price for babysitting is $15 per hour, and we have consumers Alice, Bob, Cindy, Daniel, and Ed in this small market. And their willingness to pay is $18 for Alice and $17 for Bob and so on and so forth. So you can see, as long as your willingness to pay is greater than or equal to the price, $15, then you will go ahead and hire the nanny. So you can see Ed, his willingness to pay is only $14, which is less than $15. Therefore, Ed will not hire a babysitter. And therefore, his consumer surplus will be zero because he is not participating in the market. So remember, consumer surplus cannot be negative. It is zero for Ed. Whoever is not participating in the market, your consumer surplus will be zero. So you can see consumer surplus for Alice will be 18 minus 15. That gives you 3. And Bob, his consumer surplus will be 17 minus 15. That gives you 2. And so on and so forth. Now graphically, you can see Alice, her consumer surplus is 18, her willingness to pay is 18, minus the price, $15, so her consumer surplus is $3. And Bob, his willingness to pay is 17, and the price is 15, so his consumer surplus is 2, and Cindy's 1, and Daniel's is 0. So you can sum up the consumer surplus of the entire market. That will be 3 plus 2 plus 1, and that gives you 6. What about in the real world? Well, we know in the real world there are more than just 4 consumers in the market. There are a lot of consumers in the market, and therefore your step for Alice, Bob, and Cindy is going to become really, really tiny because we have many consumers, and each of them will have a different willingness to pay. So this tiny, tiny step like that. So what is a total consumer surplus? Instead of this blue shaded area, it will be like this area. And how do we sum that up? Guess what? When you have many consumers in small steps, this is actually just your demand curve. So now you know demand curve actually reflects the value of the good or service to the consumer. And value really is just your willingness to pay, meaning the highest price you're willing and able to pay for a product or service. And in the next video, I'm going to show you how we're going to calculate the total consumer surplus of the entire market using a demand curve. For now, thanks for watching and good luck with your studying.